to take over the chairing duties for our two panel sessions, I'm delighted to introduce Dr. John Bowman. He is one of Ireland's leading broadcasters. He is an honorary fellow of Trinity College Dublin, and he's also a very distinguished historian, the award-winning De Valera and the Ulster question, and then more recently, his study of the history of RTE, Window and Mirror. So we're delighted that John was able to take time today to revive the questions and answers format and engage with these issues about the theory of how we might admit students in an ideal world, and then the practical difficulties in the second part. So I'm delighted to introduce Dr. John Bowman.
Thank you, Patrick. This would be an interactive exchange, and even those of you who are very well known to the room, I would like you to give us your name and your position on this issue, the better to understand the spin, if any, as you speak. You know, if you're making a contribution from the floor, do tell us sort of who you are. The first session, we have two sessions, and the first session is the panel who are with us here. I introduced Áine Hyland last for a reason in a moment, but Stephen McIntyre, who's second in, he leads Twitter's EMEA operations in Dublin, previously worked for Google, has an engineering degree from Trinity and Cornell, and an MBA from the Harvard Business School, and was a member of Trinity's working group on admissions and the curriculum. Aengus is the current education officer of USI, National Student Representative Body, 250,000 students. Brendan Tangney lectures in computer science at Trinity and was also a member of Trinity's working party on admissions and the curriculum. And he played a key role in the development of Bridge 21, which is a joint venture of TCD and SUAS Educational Development, and offering a new model of learning to be adapted for use in secondary schools. Áine Hyland is Emeritus Professor and former Vice President of University College Cork, chaired the Commission on the Point System, which reported over a decade ago, and was the author of the report on transition from second to third level, the Hyland Report, just published last September. And we're going to open this session by inviting Áine to give us a brief presentation.
Thank you very much indeed, John. I hope everybody can hear me. And I have entitled my very brief presentation, less than, I hope, 5 minutes, Exploring Outside the Box, because that's what we're trying to do today. And just before I start, I'd like to thank Jennifer Murphy, who's here in the audience. She's the director of NairTel, for helping me to research this and also do the get my little men inside the boxes and outside. I'm not going to talk about the point system because I think we all are familiar with it, but just to remind ourselves, there have been different point systems over the last 35 years, and there are still differences between courses and institutions. And of course, many of the alternative or additional selection approaches that are being mentioned today have been used in the past or are currently being used. And I suppose I'll appeal here for evidence-based approaches where at all possible. We do try to look at the research and we look at the evidence before we introduce something different. Again, it has been mentioned already this morning, the very large growth in the number of courses from which students can choose. In the beginning of the point system, they could choose from 69 courses. They can now choose from at least 1,330 courses. We should also, I think, just remember that the Leaving Certificate is an extraordinarily good predictor of subsequent university performance. I don't know to what extent it's a good predictor of life performance, but then on the other hand, to what extent is university performance a good predictor of life performance? And we all have responsibilities there as well. And the other issue which I have raised before, and I think we are coming a little bit closer now to a fair selection. In other words, the Leaving Certificate, and I very much welcome the developments that have already occurred, even since we discussed this less than a year ago, in terms of broadening out the intelligences that are being measured by the Leaving Certificate. And one should not underestimate that. And we shouldn't think that just because the Leaving Cert was the way it was when I did it 50 years ago or when you did it 10 years ago, that it's still the same. There are considerable changes occurring in the Leaving Certificate and in the assessment of the Leaving Certificate. So again, we needn't go into that. Now, the other thing I want to just say before I move on is that the Transitions Conference and the Transitions Debate last October was only about transition from second to third level. It was only about that proportion of students who are selected into higher education and into the university system through that process, the CAO process, focusing specifically on school leavers. Particularly for those other speakers we had this morning from other systems and other jurisdictions, we do of course have other forms of selection because we have quotas for our socioeconomically disadvantaged background students. We look at them specifically and separately. And once they meet minimum requirements, which in some cases are quite low, a range of other criteria are used, including contextual material, to look at their suitability and the probability of their being able to cope with higher education. And this has been the case for 20 years now. We have had various access schemes for 20 years. I've been within the university sector, in my own university, was on that selection committee for many, many years. And as was mentioned, the results of that selection was extraordinarily successful. The provost adverted to it himself this morning when he said there was no appreciable difference between the performance of those students and the performance of those who were brought in on the very competitive traditional point system. We also have quotas for students with disabilities, have extraordinary successes. And we have quotas for mature students. And in addition, we also, in some of our universities, have specific quotas for students who come in through FETAC, not through the Leaving Cert, but through levels 5 and 6 in further education. So there are other routes of entry, and I think we have to remember this when we're having this discussion today. And it's up to every university to decide what proportion of their places they will allocate through other forms of entry. And this does vary from institution to institution. Some have much higher proportions than others, and none of these, routes have ever been challenged. Now, one of the recommendations, I'm not going to talk about changing the Leaving Certificate and form of examination because Anne Looney will look after all that, and that'll all work out and it'll be all solved in no time. I'm just going to look at the recommendations that came from the NCCA-HEA report in December 2011 as to what we in the university sector, in the higher education sector, should be looking at. And the recommendation there, endorsed by the Minister, it's now higher education policy, that the higher education institutions individually and collectively should review their undergraduate portfolio with a view to establishing broader entry to undergraduate programmes at level 8. And this change needs to be made at system level. That's the key recommendation that came in. And that didn't come out of the sky. It came because of an awareness of what the result of over-fragmented courses has been. It has resulted in students coming into courses not fully appreciating or understanding what they're applying for and ending up dropping out. And we have some examples of that in the room today. Some people this morning talked about their own experiences, and I'm sure we have more than we are aware of. Now, having said that, I'm just going to pick up a few points about Trinity I'm contextualizing them, and these are all obviously very positive points, but there are also points that are pertinent to our discussion and particularly to our discussion about diversity. The Provost addressed, he touched on the issue of non-progression or dropout, and in fact Trinity's non-progression rate is low by national standards and very low by international standards. So non-progression in Trinity from first to second year was 8% compared to 11% in all HEA funded institutions. And Muiris O'Connor, who has done work on that, is here, and he'll be on the second panel this afternoon. Having said that, Trinity College has identified that wrong course choice was the main reason why Trinity students dropped out, and that's very well addressed in the excellent paper that that Patrick Geoghegan and his team produced for today's conference. What's also worth addressing, because it throws some light on the discussion on diversity this morning, the intake from the lower socioeconomic groups to Trinity is lower than in other universities. So, for example, it's 14% compared to an overall 21% in all HEA-funded institutions. But having said that, of course, students from lower socioeconomic groups are less likely, much less likely, to come into higher education than those from the higher and professional socioeconomic groups. Having said that, I must relook at the figures that Professor Schwartz mentioned this morning. I that didn't sound quite right to me, but we'll have a look at that again. And then another quite atypical feature of the Trinity intake is the very large proportion of whom come from private fee-paying schools. That's actually not typical of higher education generally. That's partly geographical, partly because almost all, I think 90% of the fee-paying schools are actually in the immediate catchment area of Trinity. People are often very surprised to hear in this part of Dublin that less than 4% of all second level students attend fee-paying schools nationally. However, they account for 25% at least of the intake into Trinity, and I'm taking those figures from your own report. I'm not sure if they are typical of every year or just this year. Now, the other point that one might argue, and I know there are good reasons to hold on to denominated programmes, but denominated programmes are a particular feature of Trinity. There are more denominated programmes in Trinity than there are in all the other universities put together. And I printed them out here, and there are pages and pages of them. And there are 190 separate programmes in the arts humanities areas. So a student applying to come into Trinity would have to choose from 190 to do arts in Trinity. These are generic courses in most of the other universities. So there's only one entry point, and then specialisation happens later. I'm just putting these on the table as facts. And of course, this means that your cutoff points for all your programmes in Trinity are considerably higher, which is, it's great in many ways, but it does mean, again, you have a very narrow, if you like, group of students in terms of diversity. Because the lowest cutoff point in arts is 500, that is still in the top 9% of those who apply for higher education courses, and most of the courses would be closer to the top 3-5%. That's really quite different from where it is elsewhere. Again, I'm just putting that on the table. So in that context then, we're talking about the other criteria. I'm not going to talk about them. We had some great discussions this morning. I loved the points Áine made, and Professor Schwartz made, and Professor Stenberg, whose work I have read, and I'm very interested in it in the multiple intelligences context. However, just remember, we've a lot of documented experience of many of these approaches going back 50 years or so in Ireland. Before the point system was introduced, many of these approaches were tried out, and they're documented. Now, I know that was a different time and a different era, and it is timely that we have a look at these again. Interviews, for example, and Anna's points this morning, I think, were very well made. I mean, I myself was an academic admissions person for 8 years. I coordinated 600 interviews a year for teacher education programmes. They're documented. We followed those groups of students through over a 10-year period to look at whether the interviews were, in fact, what did they add to the selection process? And I have to say, they added nothing, really. And that was, you know, that's simply the way it was. And it's documented. I suppose I'm just, again, saying, let's have evidence. Let's look at the evidence and work on evidence basis. I'm not going to go through the various points, because we'll have good discussion on it. When we were, and this is, I'm nearly finished now, when we were looking at various alternatives, or not necessarily alternatives to the Leaving Cert, but additions to the Leaving Cert to give a more rounded and holistic look at students entering university, we had a number of papers, research papers, commissioned back in 1998, and one of them was by Professor Drenthe from the Netherlands, and he just suggested these as four headings to be considered when choosing additional selection mechanisms: standardization and comparability, objectivity and reliability, make sure there are mechanisms which are fair and which candidates can't fake, and he was talking particularly about personality tests, and then construct and predictive validity. And again, there's a lot of literature on these and are worth looking at. And finally, and my last point, if I were a dictator and I were to decide what would I do if I were, and my academic council were going to obey everything I said, which is about as likely as, I would say, what about the following? Replace denominated courses with non-denominated courses. That'll bring, give you a greater variety of intake. Increase your HEAR quotas, your access quotas for lower socioeconomic disadvantage. Increase mature student quotas, perhaps increase the quota or introduce a quota of places available for applicants who have come the longer route with FETAC qualifications through further education. And, well, one would hope that such changes, if whatever changes are introduced, will be equitable. And I know fair and equitable, I know fair, see how small fair is there, I don't even use that because they're as fair as all those animals trying to climb the tree. Unbiased, transparent, reasonable, efficient, just bearing those in mind and about, and maintaining the confidence of students, their families and the public in general. And I think when we have, as we have today, somebody, Ivan from the CAO, just to put on record how extraordinarily successful the CAO has been. There's never been a legal challenge to the CAO. 35 years in Ireland, nobody has ever accused it of being biased, of being corrupt. It's been a huge success. So, but having said that, the CAO will do whatever the universities will tell it to do because the universities own the CAO. So thank you very much, and I hope we have a good discussion.
Thank you, Áine. I'm going to, first of all, I'm going to ask the rest of the panel for their responses to that. Stephen McIntyre.
Well, first of all, just to say a little bit about my background. So I've worked in high-tech firms all my career, and more recently in internet firms, like where I was for 7 years, and then more recently, are we going to try this?
Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah. At the back? Okay, great. I've worked in high-tech firms all my career, and more recently in internet firms like Google, where I was for 7 years, and then just for the last 2 months at Twitter. And I was thinking when I was watching Georgina speak earlier on, is Georgina here still? Georgina is the personification of what I look for when I'm hiring somebody. And over the last 7 years at both Google and at Twitter, essentially my job has been to build teams. And before I left Google, I checked, I had interviewed more than 400 people. I've already interviewed more than 100 people since I joined Twitter 2 months ago. And I've seen a lot of people with different academic track records, usually, by the way, especially at Google, people who had gone to elite universities and who had done very well academically. And I've seen, at least anecdotally, how these people do, whether they end up being really high performers or just solid or even sometimes low performers, which does happen. And I was thinking about what is the single characteristic that I might look for most. And if I had to pick just one thing, it would be initiative. And when Georgina spoke earlier on, that thing initiative was just, it just radiated from her. And actually the small episode that she talked about showed so many important characteristics of success in not just business, but probably in life, between coming up with an idea, but knowing not to stop there, having the persistence to execute on something, push on with it regardless. And linking it back just to what Áine was talking about, I don't really know how you admit people at the start of that funnel to try and encourage those kinds of characteristics. But if one of the objectives of the university admissions process is to help people to find their passion in life and maybe even help to fast track it a little bit, and because it usually takes even very successful people a long time to kind of find that passion where they can be very successful and use their initiative and really want to do things without being asked. Somehow I think the university admissions process could play a part. And getting people into the right courses early on, I think plays a big part in that. Exactly how that would be done, I'm afraid I have to hold my hands up and say there are other people from academia who might be better qualified to say than I. I can speak a little bit more about how people with different academic characteristics and have done in the business environment.
So Stephen, just on that, are you saying that you know a lot more about the candidate at an interview, at the end of the interview, than you did looking at the paper?
Interviews themselves are kind of funny because after all these 500 interviews, I think still my conclusion is it's like an interview is like a mirage in the desert, and it sort of seems like something that you should aim for, but it's never enough. And the more interviews I do, the more I realize that they're not great. And I always try to look for another data point. And if I can possibly find somebody who has worked with this person, I'll always choose that over my own judgment after interviewing them.
How do you measure initiative?
It's what you've done in your life. It's not what you say you've done in an interview. But it's what you've done in your life.
So it's on the CV, but CVs can be faked. I mean, self-regulation.
Everything can be faked. Yeah, but I guess by adding in.
No, but the Leaving Cert arguably can't be faked. I mean, it was your performance of the day. But
yes.
But we've all seen CVs where we know the person.
Yeah.
It's very impressive.
Yeah.
But we know. We've all been there. Americans are particularly good. The CV, it gives you. They go into all sorts of detail. Yeah.
But I guess we're even having this discussion because we've accepted that there are certain biases even in that system.
Yeah.
And so I guess by adding a few additional data points, we might be able to have checks and balances.
Okay.
Form a picture.
Aengus.
Can I start just by taking up you up on the point you just made that the Leaving Cert can't be faked? The Leaving Cert can be bought. And this is the key point that I think we need to address here. That if we're talking about a completely transparent, fair, but soullessly and heartlessly transparent as the CAO is, or as the Leaving Cert is, you will not find a better system of saying, yes, these are the results this person got in those six exams, in those 3 weeks, in that June of their 17th or 18th year. Yes, the Leaving Cert tells us that, and it is fantastic at doing that. However, the Leaving Cert, I honestly don't believe the Leaving Cert can be seen as an entrance test for higher education. I think they're trying to achieve completely different things, and that's becoming more and more stark. And I heartily encourage the reforms that are happening in the senior cycle. When we look at something where we have 190 denominated courses in first year in Trinity, and you've just come from having a very general education at 18, and then 3 months later you start doing medieval Russian and Spanish, and that's you for the next 4 years. Bridging that gap can't happen automatically, and no one can expect it to happen automatically, and nor should anyone. I believe there is a job of higher education not to cope with a supposed poor quality of entrance to higher education, but to take the people that the Leaving Cert spits out and turn them into the specialists that they want them to be, rather than expecting them at 18 years and 2 months old to already be scholars, to already be critical thinkers, to already be doing the things that we become as we finish higher education. It can't be done overnight, and it can't be done automatically by flicking a switch going from the Leaving Cert, which absolutely goes out of its way to disincentivize all those things, into higher education, which does the complete opposite. So that's one point I want to make. There's also a point about the higher education sector trying to cope with it and trying to impose sort of restrictions on the sort of people it all of a sudden wants. I want to talk specifically about Matt's bonus points. This is an issue where the higher education sector generally said, Irish people aren't good enough at maths. Right, we're going to click our fingers and all of a sudden everyone's going to get 25 points better at maths. No, because those people started being failed in terms of their maths education 14, 15 years before today. So the difference between a person who got into a course in Trinity College last year with a C3, as I got in ordinary level maths because I was doing music and had absolutely no skill or interest in doing that, or the person who goes into Trinity next year with the extra 25 points, getting a theoretical 625 points, I actually don't think there is any, despite the fact that they have this alleged recognition of the fact that they did higher level maths. It's also not appropriate in many cases. What impact does maths have on someone's capacity to be a scholar of ancient classics? I would argue very little. So there's a tendency to be incredibly general and sweeping, and almost, if you'll forgive me, panicky when it comes to solving solutions like this, when we need to be looking much more broadly at the education system in the nation, and more specifically to what we're talking about today, we should look at what it takes an 18-year-old or a new entrant, no matter what route they came into, from being just a citizen into being a scholar, and end this expectation that it just has to happen automatically, and that if the student isn't at that point by the end of their first semester, that they have failed. I believe it is higher education's responsibility to make that transition themselves.
Thank you, Aengus. Brendan Tangney.
And the question is?
The question is a response to Áine.
Response to Áine, okay. If I just start with her specific comments about TSM, which is the Trinity Awards, Trinity Awards for lots of different things, is the arts degree and the denominated courses, which were mentioned there. So I'm a computer scientist originally, and we just teach a computer science course, so you can do computer science or not do it. But in the TSM argument, if I go back to what Cardinal Newman said 150 years ago, he said, it doesn't actually matter what you study, as long as you study it in sufficient depth and detail, and for the love of studying and for the subject itself. Right? So I think I would regard that as being a defense of TSM. So if you come in and you study, you know, Hebrew and biblical studies for 4 years, and you do that in depth and you do that with rigor, you will get a good education, and you will produce, you will produce those things that I think Stephen was referring to, critical thinking and stuff like that. Right. So I wouldn't necessarily go jumping in with a single bland entry course into arts. I think there is merit in the four-year specialized degree in one or two subjects. I think that has merit. The other thing I'd say is that educational change is horrendously complicated. And what you discover when you try and change one bit is that you can't really do that in isolation, and you have to look at the thing in its totality. Right. So I think, and again, Professor Hyland mentioned it, the work that's going on in the NCCA and the change that are happening in the secondary school system are hugely important in changing the whole Irish educational landscape. Right. So the work that's going on in the junior cycle is going to feed into the system, and the project which was mentioned, which I'm involved in, Bridge 21, is trying to assist in that process by actually transforming what's happening in classrooms today, not in 5 years' time. Right. The change of assessment in the Leaving Cert, which is in the offering, is going to be important, right? And one of the key things in the NCCA approach is they're putting the responsibility back on the schools for saying, well, look, how are you going to teach these skills and how are you going to assess them? And then I think the responsibility falls on the universities that if we're asking the teachers and the schools and the school system to look at what it's doing, then I think we as the university sector and the third level sector, we have to practice what we preach and we have to do the same. So I think it's very timely for us to reflect in our admission process, and as the Provost indicated this morning, we need to reflect on what we do once we have people in college. Right? Next point I'd make is, you know, the system is, there are fundamental flaws in the CAO admission system as we have it at today. It's transparent, it's fair after a fashion. Right? But it's changed the way people behave, and it's changed the nation's attitudes towards learning. Right? And I think we really can't lose sight of that. And people will learn what's rewarded. People, you know, bring Skinner and behaviorism into it. You know, we're conditioned, and people will learn, and they'll do what they need to do to get into college. So if we're valuing things like creativity and collaboration, and if we're valuing potential, this most nebulous of things, how do you measure it? Then if we really value those, we have to put some things in place to reward them. Because otherwise we're going to get, you know, the parody of the Leaving Cert where people can prove it for the triangle ABC, but they can't prove it for the triangle XYZ, right? And now that's a parody, and there's lots of intelligent people out there. But the system as it stands at the moment is having a distorting effect on people's approach to learning, right? And I think that's a national crisis, and it needs to be addressed. And it needs to be addressed now, not in 10 years' time. We've been talking about, you know, reform for ages and ages and ages. Never before, at least in the past 20 or 30 years, have the stars been so favorably aligned to allow us to bring about change in the system. You know, between the external financial meltdown, the current Minister for Education that we have, the fruits of what's been done in the NCCA over the years, right? It's all coming together. And I think if we don't seize the day now, our children will regret it in 20 and 30 years' time if we don't do something now. Right? If Donal O'Malley waited around to get the Department of Finance and the Department of Education and the Fianna Fáil party on side before he brought in free education, three quarters of the people sitting in this room wouldn't be sitting here, right? We've benefited from his thing. And the last thing I'd say about this whole debate is, how do we measure success? Well, you know, we're the wrong people to be asking, because we're the ones that have, that it benefits. Right? You know, we came through the system and, you know, we're good at it, and we've come out the other side. So the people I worry about are the ones that don't benefit from the system, and the ones who have the potential, you know, the Provost physics student this morning, who could make a great physicist, but we can't get him in here, right? So maybe the next time Patrick is running one of these sessions, he should wander out to Grafton Street, or probably Henry Street, and get 20 or 30 people from there and get them in here and ask them what they think of us and what we're doing, and we might get a very different perspective on it. So I question on Hyland's assumption that the thing is successful and it's working. I think your question is that it depends on the parameters that you're using to measure success and the frame of reference that you're measuring it by.
Thank you for that. Áine, how do, I mean, the point is that every education system, or all educational policy, is driven and has been over the centuries by those who have been the products of it. And that's obviously self-fulfilling. But what is the, what's your response to the to that point, that at the moment it is not capturing all sorts of qualities in our potential citizenry, I won't use the word student, and also the fact that it's distorting what happens in school anyway, that this, that it just distorts because of the Skinner point.
Yes. Yeah.
Behaviour is determined by its consequences.
Indeed. Yeah, and I think the tail is the examination, and it wags the curriculum. And I think, again, everybody, I think, around the table here agrees that, of course, up to now, or traditionally, most of the Leaving Cert subjects don't reward all forms of intelligence, and they are the examinations are relatively narrow in what they measure. 12 years ago, the Points Commission, having given a lot of thought and consideration to this, saw the solution in the changing the way the Leaving, first of all, changing the curriculum of the Leaving Certificate, and then changing the way in which the Leaving Certificate is assessed. Because the point system, after all, is only a mathematical formula which builds on the Leaving Certificate. That's all it is. It doesn't do anything in itself. So basically, if the Leaving Certificate rewarded a broader range of abilities and aptitudes and intelligences, as is now being proposed, and the issue of the predictability of the Leaving Certificate examination was addressed, so that students can't be grind it or ground to sit the examination, I think we would be going a long way towards meeting that if you like, the goal that everybody has, is that we should reward broader ranges of intelligences and of abilities and of aptitudes.
And we can't afford not to.
And we can't afford not to, exactly. Yeah. And I think that there is a very real and genuine attempt to do that now. And as Brendan has said, the time is right.
And is it feasible in your view?
Yes, I think it is. I mean, there are people here who can answer that better than I can. I mean, people like Anne Looney, who's here, and people from the State Examinations Commission, who will be on the next panel.
Yeah.
But yeah, I certainly see no reason why it shouldn't be. I mean, I'm very familiar, say, with Sternberg's work. Sternberg has very similar sort of views to the Howard Gardner multiple intelligences approaches, and work that many of us have been doing with schools, and Bridge 21 is also doing with schools. We do recognise that it is feasible, and that teachers and second level schools are willing to work towards this broader curriculum. But as long as the examination only measures the narrower skills, of course, in the examination years, they will focus on those skills.
Who wants to contribute from the room? Yes.
Stephen Schwartz, can I just ask you a question about the mathematics, Professor Hyland? If we have, say, 10 art schools, each with 100 students, and we have a 590 points cutoff, how does that get lowered by just lumping all of those together? Why isn't it still 590, unless you have more students?
No, what happens, I think, is something somewhat different. It's because, if you look at it nationally, there is phrase that was being used this morning, that you heard being used, that students don't want to waste their points. So when students know that the cutoff points for specific courses are very high, 5 out of 600, say 560, 570, 580, those courses by definition become desirable courses. There's nothing more desirable than a course you can't get into. And I think that it's that phenomenon.
Why does that get lower?
Because nationally, if you looked at my
it doesn't get lower at the TCB though, does it? Unless they take more students.
But they might be
the
different.
Cutoff will be exactly the
same. Probability is there'll be different students. It'll be more evenly. It is likely to be more evenly distributed. Yeah. Well.
Sorry, John.
I accept what you're saying. Somebody else may be able to answer that.
Somebody who works in admissions, it's just simply a question of a quota. For each of those subcategories of the quota.
Yeah, you need a microphone, I think. Yeah. Sorry. Just Patrick's bringing it.
I suppose it's just somebody who works in admissions. It's simply a question of quotas. So if you have a course and you only have 5 places or 10 places, the candidate on the 10th place will have 550 points.
I understand that.
Whereas,
if
I could just, so what I suppose Professor Howland's saying is that you'd have an omnibus entry, as would be the case in many of the colleges, where you might have 600 or 700 places. And then what you do is you could add to the 600 person, and the 600 has 10 points levels, which are more, I suppose, more regular to the norm of the population. That's how that works.
It could be argued, I think, as well, that you respond then more, because if you have an omnibus in and a load of people want to do economics, you may provide more economics. So actually, I think there's probably an advantage that may regulate supply and demand of particular subbits of humanities better than if the perception is you only have 20, I think.
That's not entirely true, except you'll have more redistribution across the universities. In practice, that's what I understand the point you're making, but in practice, they redistribute more across the universities.
Yes, here.
Because they go.
My name is Rachel Barron, Students' Union Education Officer here in Trinity. And I'm conscious that I don't want this to turn into a debate about generic courses, but I've just 2 points that I wanted to make. Firstly, I mean, I know that a lot of people come into college not really knowing necessarily what they want to do, but a lot of people come into college knowing exactly what they want to do. And I mean, we can see in England that, you know, there are very few subject choices, so that people who excel in certain areas simply study the things that they like studying, that they love studying, that they go to university and do the things that they love studying. And an interesting, I guess, anecdote that I've had from this year is here we have one, I guess you'd call it a generic course in Trinity, it's science, and people come in and then they go on to do more specialised things later. And there's one student who came into my office and she had missed, she'd come in, she'd wanted to do zoology. Zoology was the only thing she'd ever wanted to do, and she had to study science, and when it came to the aptitude test to do the zoology, she didn't get zoology, and she spent 2 years in the higher education system and didn't end up getting what she wanted to do. So that's one issue. And the second issue as well is how do you deal with the issue that, we're talking about the points race at second level. There is a risk that if generic courses were to be introduced across the board, that the issue would transport to third level, as we would have in science, where over 100 students had to sit repeats during the points race for these courses like zoology. So there are issues with, if you are you pushing it back to third level then?
How much evidence do we have, Áine, about those coveted points and people wandering, not wandering, but going in to get their first choice, even when they don't have much of a vocation for it, but because the points are coveted and they've won the points, that they then decided to say to do medicine?
There is some evidence for that. I don't know how widespread it is. This morning it was mentioned, I think it was Patrick mentioned, a number of students on a law course whose, it was their sixth preference. The first five preferences were all in medicine. They had put down medicine in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 universities, and then number 6 was law because they didn't want to waste their points, more or less. So there is that type of evidence that there are a certain type of student, and unfortunately also sometimes a certain type of school, because it looks good for the results of the school to have so many students getting into medicine, getting into law, getting into the prestigious or perceived to be prestigious faculties. So yeah, there's some evidence for that. There are lots of admissions officers here, and there are people from the CAO who will be able to answer that.
Yeah. Aengus, you want to come in on that?
I just wanted to pose a thought to people, maybe. is how many brilliant, world-changing engineers and computer scientists and marketers and all of these things that were asked, that, you know, that we're responding to all the time from national policy, how many brilliant, world-changing people like that are currently mediocre doctors and lawyers up and down the country for this very reason?
Yeah. Well, I do know that Kevin Roach is probably the most distinguished Irish architect and among the top 10 in the world. He was the son of the creamery manager in Mitchelstown, and he wandered in to architecture when he thought he was going to agriculture on the first day in Earlsford Terrace. And discovered he was an architect, yeah. And still practicing in his 90s, yeah. So, serendipity. I mean, this is the point you were making about some of the pupils didn't know what they wanted to do, and some had their minds made up to do zoology. Both are absolutely fair, aren't they? They're both perfectly legitimate positions to be in when you're 17 or 18. I mean, I think that's one of the very big points to this. And is the Trinity thing where they bring people in and they ask them to identify a particular course? Are you saying, Áine, I think between the lines you were saying that you thought that was far too prescriptive, yeah. Yes, here. So, does it matter? First man here, yeah.
Yeah, I think there are a number of alternative models other than just the omnibus and the denominational model, because, and I think it's always interesting when you look at entrance, the entrance process, one should also look at the exit process, because if at the end of the first year, if there are options for movement, I think having pathways and flexibility so that you could still have a denominational model, but you could deal with the requirement that some students have, but not all students, that they want to move out of a particular path that they find themselves into. So that's an intermediate, so I don't think it's either omnibus or denominational. You could have a process that is both, to be honest. Especially, I think, if the first year is a relatively generic year across the denominational courses. And I think there's a great need for that, considering, for example, that philosophy isn't taught on the second level. I think it would be quite appropriate to have critical thinking skills, information literacy skills, communication skills, computing skills in first year in particular.
Which would be useful
no matter what course they're going to.
Even if they dropped out, it would be useful.
Yeah.
Yes, behind you there. Yeah.
Brenda made the point earlier that people come into Trinity. They don't, they get in. Well, I think that's part of the point in university. You don't have the choice of just coming in. Áine could have put up further figures. If you look at a comparison, for instance, on cutoff points for medicine, you'll see that although Trinity will have higher points, the difference between the four or five medical colleges are actually very little. So that the arts comparison, I think, is a genuine comparison between those. But as my colleague who's just spoke previously said, there's a spectrum between it. No one does a generic first year arts course. People still have to select. And you can walk in and do three completely different subjects to the person who's walked in beside you. The point, I think, largely has to do with at what point you start the selection process and how much that backwashes into the secondary system, remembering that in Ireland we still sit our terminal examination at a very young age, and these decisions drive that back further. It's not that people
we're
can't
about a year younger, aren't we?
True,
then?
Yeah. But it's not that people can't perform excellently once they're in. I think people have to focus on the fact you can only teach the people who come in the door. If they can't get in, you can never find out the potential that was there. And I think that's what the provost was trying to say, that even with power, you know, our system or the systems we've put in place, some people are simply prevented from getting in to ever find out what we could do. And that's something I think that we should certainly look at changing.
Right. Okay. Yes, here. Can I invite those with the, yeah, with, I was going to say, I was thinking, thought for a minute, there were two marked ones, yeah, okay.
I really liked Stephen's reference to, you know, initiative being something that is really desirable in selecting people for the team building and the work that you're doing. And I think we could apply that equally to the transition from, and even transitions indeed, but the one we're talking about here is the one from second level schooling into higher education. It's how you actually measure that initiative. I mean, we saw a very good example of it here this morning with Georgina. But you can't recreate that in an examination situation. You can only see it, I think, over time. And I think that relates a little bit as well to the Leaving Cert as an examination. And while it does a lot of good things, and if we make the changes to the assessment that we're proposing at the moment, it'll probably do a lot of better things. But while it remains the only measure and the only way of transferring from second level to third level, it remains extremely high stakes. And in that situation, people will always find a way to buy their way through it, because it's the one exit entry point, the one gateway, the one little dark archway that you have to come through. And therefore, you'll find a way of buying that or recreating it. And those with the best capacity to do that will always do that. So I suppose the point I'm making really is that while the Leaving Cert can address a certain amount, I don't think it can ever do that on its own, that it probably needs some other mechanisms alongside it to be able to broaden out the kinds of skills and capacities that we would like to measure to bring people in, you know, to the next stage where they can build on those skills, capacities, and hopefully initiative that will lead them on to a successful life both at university and in life itself.
How much evidence do we have about the quality of advice that pupils get across the educational spectrum about filling in their preferences? Because presumably a very high proportion are end up getting their third or fourth preference rather than their first because they don't get the points. And I'm right in saying that is then a legal requirement to take up whatever the isn't that right, Amy? You can only take up the one that that trips in, as it were. And I'm just wondering how well advised are our pupils across the country, because it would presumably vary hugely between schools in terms of resources. Who wants to take that?
Well,
yes.
I can't really, I can only speak anecdotally and individually.
Yeah.
I'm a guidance counsellor, and I write about career guidance in a column.
Well, then you're very well placed to speak, yeah.
My biggest regret in recent educational cutbacks are cutbacks in guidance, because we're talking about an unfair system. We all know that. It's unfair from the moment of birth. And everything you suggest can be improved by parents having money to do something. We were just talking briefly at the coffee break about perhaps doing a year in a nursing home in order to get into nursing homes or into medicine or into nursing or medicine. If that were a requirement, parents would be buying places of work experience in nursing homes for a year. They'd be buying places empty in bed. You know. So I'm just going back to the fact that the people who rely most on guidance counsellors are the students from socioeconomic disadvantage. They are the people who have nothing really but their guidance counsellor. They have, to quote a guidance counsellor whom I knew before I became one myself, they have no pictures in their mind. I always found that a very graphic image that she gave me, that students who had no pictures in their own mind as to where they might go or what they might do or what was out there or what jobs were or what a particular function was, and the only person they have to give it to them is the guidance counsellor. And they are being cut back and back and back. And there is a huge load of responsibility in the guidance council. We don't all do the job as well as we might try our best. But you have to be on top of everything, you have to be listening, you have to be encouraging, you have to be telling them to aim high, you have to be preparing them for the safety nets, you have to be preparing them for the number three, but telling them if you want medicine in Trinity or anywhere else, equally good or better or not as good, you can aim for it. Don't mind if you don't get it, you can aim for it. But you have to make sure that they have aimed as high as they want and that they have put in the safety nets. But you need tremendous resources to do it. And I don't know how much I did a survey myself. I remember graphically one thing that one student said in the survey to me was about her guidance counselor, just at the bottom of the thing. She was 50 plus, she hadn't a clue. Well, that kind of put me but it is vital. So that's really.
And who signs the CAO form? Is the student?
Oh, the student fills it out completely themselves.
Yeah.
And if I just say one last thing, do they
need parental co-signature?
Because you have parents ringing you in the summertime and saying she's got a place in Athlone and we live in Sutton. I never knew she applied for Athlone.
Yeah.
I mean, really. And I just say one last thing about the TSM, because it does take a lot of choices. If you have 10 choices and 10 of them are all going to be TSMs in Trinity two subject mods and you don't get in, You've nothing. Or even if you do get in, and I totally accept the fact that you want to study in depth and Newman's idea and everything else, but if you don't like one of those subjects, this is not an environment that allows you to a little flexibility, a little change. I really think universities in their first year should be very flexible and very accommodating to students as far as they can be.
Can I just ask the room on that point, given particularly what has already been said, that that most of our pupils and students are a year younger than they would be in many other countries, and that year is hugely important. Most of us, it's a long time back, but we can appreciate just how immature we were, although we thought we knew all the answers. So isn't it surely important to allow the Kevin Roaches to switch in that way if they discover coming in for the first time with their responsibility to go to their own lectures and no classroom regimentation? They're discovering all sorts of things. Coming from a single-sex school, suddenly they discover that the world has more than just the boys or whatever. So isn't there a huge argument for flexibility, particularly in the first year? And why isn't there more of it? Or is there enough of it? Anybody want to pick up on that? Yes, yeah.
This is the senior tutor.
I'm Claude, I'm the senior tutor in Trinity, and as part of my job I would regularly see students who feel they've made the wrong course choices, and I would like to support your case for guidance counsellors. We don't need less, we need more guidance counsellors, and I think also in terms of access, the point you've made is extremely valid. In terms of flexibility, if I take the case of Trinity, there is some flexibility for students to change and transfer. There are constraints imposed on it in terms of places available in some courses, but also in terms of the CAO points, it would be unfair in the current system to admit a student in a certain course who has the points for that course and then allow them 2 months later to transfer for a course that has higher points.
Sure, yeah.
That creates kind of issues of equity.
Yeah.
But certainly, I don't know about the other institutions, but within the restrictions of the points and places being available, there is some flexibility during first year. There is some flexibility at the end of first year as well. So
it's
not all bleak now. Each institution would have its own way of dealing with the problem.
Yeah. And how much information do we have about the 8% who drop out in Trinity? And do you capture that? Are you happy that you're capturing the reason why you've lost them?
Yes, I mean, yes, there has been work done quite intensively. Some of it goes back a number of years. Course choice seems to be the main issue now. It's quite often students see it as the easy explanation to give, and quite often saying, I made the wrong course choice. When you start looking into it, there might be all sorts of other issues hiding behind that.
Okay.
Not fitting in socially, I think, probably is more important than we think.
Or than they admit.
And then
okay. Yeah. Patrick had an idea here, which he shared with you, I think, by inviting you to put down some answers to this question. In an ideal world, how would you fill a hypothetical 10 places on a course if all the other places were filled using existing methods? And we've had a number of responses to that. Does anybody want to stand up and share their answer to that question with the room? Yes.
Damien Owens, Engineers Ireland. I looked at the guy, I interpreted the question as just taking, you know, you fill most of the spaces, or you're looking at validation for the last remaining places. And given that we're in a world of, electronic world, a virtual world, virtually every student, leaving cert, student, whatever, coming in, before they even come in through the doors, has already created a digital footprint. So you can look on through social media or whatever and see exactly, you know, do they have they been drinking in the beta is one thing, but also have the aptitude for anything that they're applying for. In other words, if they're applying for a vet, if they've worked on, you know, helping animals down at a local vet.
Are you suggesting that they would alert you to what's on their Facebook, or that you would spy in and investigate?
A bit of both. It'd be permission based, and it allows It is a peer reviewed, so in other words, their classmates will be saying, yes, he did this or he didn't, but also it allows interaction with the college before the student even comes in. The college could, for example, have a dialogue with them, set them a challenge or questions or whatever. Now, you may think it would take a lot of work to do that, and again, it's only for validation, it wouldn't be the only assessment method. But, you know, any HR people in the room here will tell you that before they interview, bringing anyone for interview, they've already looked you up on Facebook and LinkedIn and all. So it's already happening in the professional world. Maybe it should happen in the academic world. Just a view.
Okay, yes, here. Yes.
Conor Galvin, University College Dublin. It's the other place out the road. just to chase down what you said there about the, you know, what my suggestion would be, I think I would be inclined to just emphasise what Professor has actually said earlier. You know, there is a lot of very good work going on already, and there are programmes like The Bridge that are starting to make a huge difference as well, which Brendan spoke about. I think what we really need to do to fill those 10 places is to find ways of allowing, inviting, getting children, getting young people onto those courses, bridge-type courses, summer-type courses, whatever it takes, to let them get a flavour, to let them get a feel of the different campuses, to let them see what it's like to meet real university students acting as mentors and so on, to do the outreach thing in a way that we've done in some courses, we've done very effectively in some courses, but there's a huge amount of work to be done there still. I think it's actually one-to-one, you know, recruiting in. We have to go to them increasingly to find, you know, ways of bringing these kids into our system. And the TAB program, I think Brendan's program, is exceptionally interesting in regard to what they're trying to do there. You know, the idea of transition year kids getting to meet university students from all over Trinity, you know, to talk to them, to experience them, to work with them on activities. And it's not about schoolwork, it's about activities, it's about projects, it's about having a bit of fun, using technical, you know, Facebook type things as well, but in a way that the kids are in control, not us.
Yeah.
I wouldn't at all be in favour of us starting to take on any of the bad habits of asking for Facebook passwords or anything like that. That, I think, is something that academic people shouldn't do. But that's just my own feeling on that.
Yeah. Brendan, do you want to?
Okay, so the Trinity Access Programme for 20 years now has been doing Trojan work in outreach and engaging with people, and I think the Provost mentioned it this morning and other speakers have mentioned it, right? So I think the work that Clean and our people have been doing and have been done in other colleges is exactly the sort of thing that one of the things we should be doing. But I suppose the main point I'd make is that it's not one size fits all, and it's not a question of this or that. I think we're presenting ourselves here with some false arguments, right? You know, we need to do lots of things to solve this problem, and it's not an either or. And if you're, it goes back to this fixation with the one data point. There's very few other walks in life where we make huge decisions based on one single data point, right? So I think that's a huge flaw in the current system that we have, right? And what I'd be arguing for is that we need to have, you know, if Gardner spoke about multiple intelligences, then we need to recognise them. No researcher here would present solid research findings based on one survey. We do triangulation. It's what we expect of ourselves as a profession. So why don't we do some element of triangulation of multiple data sources, whatever is appropriate for whatever course, right, whatever the context is. Now, we're clever people. I think we can work out ways of doing it, right? So that's what I would implore us to do. And it's not an either or, you know, either the CO or interviews. You know, that's not the right argument to do it. And then we have to change what's happening in the schools. Right, and we have the universities, I'd say, reiterate what I said earlier, I mean, we in the universities have to step up to the mark as well. We have to look at what we're doing in our admissions process, and we have to look at the type of teaching and learning and assessment that we do within the university, which the Provost also mentioned this morning. Right, and we got to do them all, and we got to join up the thinking and not sort of say, well, this is your problem or this is us problem. This is a mutual problem that the education system has. I think we need to think creatively about it, and we all need to do our bit. But really, the universities have the pivotal role because we're the gatekeepers for the product that everybody wants. So I think there's huge responsibility on us to step up to the mark and to be seen to reward those other things and to outreach in as many innovative different ways as we possibly can, right, is what we should be doing.
And Aengus, if those innovations happened, do you, and the system where the points the CAO, the point system plus some sort of flexibility, how confident would you be that the those extra places wouldn't be somehow won by people who were just near misses, rather than encompassing people with more of a social inclusion, people who are on the fringes of the whole system? Wouldn't the places tend to be captured by the near misses?
Yes, yeah, probably. Which is kind of sad and slightly depressing to say. It's one of the interesting things that was mentioned earlier, this kaleidoscope idea that was used in America. If that was the system here, I mean, it happened with medical aptitude tests that it was meant to be completely fair and transparent, and all of a sudden there was grind courses and this thing. If that was the national system here, exactly the same thing would happen, and millionaires would be made overnight who had gone through it successfully once. I would love to be able to imagine that there was a completely fair system. This is why I keep saying that we have to think about the whole sector, and we have to talk about when people get into higher education, that there are mobile within it, instead of all of a sudden turning over the next chance card. No, out you go, back up to start again, and you can pay for it while you're on the way, thank you very much. And this is me speaking as a college dropout myself, and having had to start up from scratch again. I know exactly what you're saying, that would happen. Maybe you sort of keep modulating and change it every 3 years so that these things can't happen. I honestly don't know.
Stephen.
In the business world, the larger an organization becomes, the bigger the bet you have to make to make any impact on the system. And so I find myself always agreeing with nearly everything that Brendan ever says. But one of the assumptions that we've had in some of these discussions is about this 10 places at the margin. I hate that. I mean, we're dealing with a massive system with huge inertia built in. If we really want to massively change it, we have to think big and take a big step. If we're gonna talk about changing something, change all of law and Trinity in 1 year, with all of the massive ripples that will create. And I know there could be all sorts of reasons, 100 reasons right now for saying why that's not possible, but 10 places at the margin, dealing at the margin here, guarantees the status quo. It guarantees it. And on a second related point about adding in extra data points, there was kind of an inference, I think, a few times, totally understandably, that introducing something like interviews would kind of guarantee corruption of the system and old boys network and all that kind of thing. And there's a huge history of that, of course, in the country. But look, again, in order to change the status quo, we have to have confidence in ourselves somehow. Don't assume that corruption is inevitable. I mean, if we assume that, it will be, or we'll never do anything. The only way that we're going to change the status quo is to have faith in ourselves to act differently than the way it was done in the past. So I do have faith that if we try something big, we'll at least learn from it, even if it fails first time around.
But policymakers are preoccupied by measurement, and they over-measure things, and they love statistics because there's a safety and a comfort in it. But there are many, and this is at the heart of this issue, I think, there are many salient dimensions which are not easily measured. So isn't that what we're really talking about?
How would you even attempt to measure something as small as 10 places?
No, I'm not talking about the 10 places. I'm talking about the talents that we're missing, the talents that are not reaching their potential in our current educational system. That's what I'm talking about. So how do you isolate those? And not easy.
Professor Hyland?
Yeah.
Well, I suppose I'd just like to sort of end this part of the proceedings by, I suppose, trying to be positive and saying we've come a very long way. Certainly in my lifetime, half a century in education, we have come a long way. 50 years ago, 5% of the school leavers, 5% of the 18-year-olds went into university. When I was in boarding school, the nuns said to me, "Remember, girls, you're the cream of the country, rich and thick." And that's how we got into the university. We were able to buy our way in because there was no selection system. As long as you could pay the fees, you could get in. Ireland was never a meritocracy like the UK. That wasn't the way. I mean, after the Second World War, the UK higher education system was meritocratic. Ireland's wasn't. It was whoever could pay the fees, as you know. And the situation now, I have to be careful, and I know I fully respect Aengus's views and the views of his colleagues, but there are grants for students who have reached the point to get in. So financially, at that point, it, while it's difficult, and that was pointed out this morning, it's not impossible. The real issue of inequality happens in the womb, basically. And certainly, and we are moving, and there are people here today who have been involved in introducing the early years, the first preschool year. Ireland, we're way behind other countries. We're now finally getting our act together on trying to redress the imbalance from very early time, from junior infants right up to the end of primary, second level. And I think the various access programs have recognized this and are now working back with the younger and younger people. And I think that's where we have to try and break down the inequalities. But we are considerably better. The first surveys that were carried out in the early 80s by Pat Clancy showed a difference of 20 times. You had 20 times better chance of getting into university if you were from a professional family. That has been reduced to 4 times more. Now, it's not by any means perfect, but there are significant improvements. And if we just keep really push very hard, of course it's not a fair system and it's not anyway ideal, but it's better than what it used to be. And as I say, with the young generation here now who are very conscious of it, I think it will continue to get better and I'm very optimistic for
okay.
the future.
On that optimistic note, we're going to change panels and now get the policymakers in, or those who have to, or gatekeepers. So thank you very much. Now, let me introduce our second panel. Muiris O'Connor is Principal Officer in Policy and Planning at the HEA and is a member of the Expert Group on Future Skills Needs. Joseph O'Grady is Operations Manager at the CAO. Lewis Purser is Director of Academic Affairs at the Irish Universities Association. Dr. Jim Murray has the same title, Director of Academic Affairs for the Institute of Technology in Ireland. And Dr. Anne Looney is Chief Executive of the NCCA, the National Council for Curriculum and Assessment. And could I ask you first, Muiris, I'll put the question this way. What do you know now that you didn't know at 2 o'clock? if anything, yeah.
I don't know a whole lot more than I did at 2 o'clock, but I have a positive sense of the possibilities of change. And I think what's maybe particularly important and where the potential is that there's a whole of education perspective emerging around this issue that has great potential. I think that the characteristics that we require of graduates of higher education must be nurtured and developed at all levels of the education system from very early stages onwards. These are critical thinking, analytical thinking, research skills, information literacy, kind of intellectual nimbleness and the ability to be job shapers rather than job seekers. So I think there's a consistency there, and I'm a little bit concerned about the debate this morning where the focus was on limitations of the Leaving Cert and on additional modalities of assessment that could be added to it. And Trinity, in its own internal deliberations, is considering a lot of different options, including interviews, statements, personal statements, references, and examples of extracurricular activity. However, most of the alternative modalities I have heard about raise very serious problems for me, and I would think.
What are they?
That they'll absolutely intensify the socioeconomic inequalities, because all of the additional modalities raise massive issues. And to the extent that there are valuable additionalities to our upper secondary assessment, and some of them we came through very strongly in the rainbows and kaleidoscope schemes that we heard about, I think these additionalities must be intentionally incorporated into the Leaving Certificate itself. And that should be our focus. So to the extent that anything's valuable, it's valuable in the context of the Leaving Cert reform. And the point is worth making again, and Áine's made it, and Looney's made it, that the curriculum in secondary is actually quite broad. And if you read the objectives of the curriculum, it actually corresponds very much with what we all believe is proper. It's the assessment that's overly narrow, and it's the intensity of competition arising from the point system that pushes out maybe the space for the development of the skills, the critical thinking, the analytical thinking, the team working especially is almost absent in our senior cycle.
But doesn't that narrow gateway at the assessment and the points, that drives itself back through the school year to
yes.
delimiting what the teacher might introduce?
Yeah, it
turns
does.
That into a strategy rather than a broader educational
it,
experience.
It does, and we will not get away from a reasonably we will always have, and we should have, a competitive meritocratic-based access system, and I think a centralised application facility is vital in any democracy, and that's why I said that the focus should be on expanding the Leaving Cert and letting that be the case. But I think there's a lot of unnecessary heat in the competitiveness around the Leaving Cert system, and we need to get rid of it now because we have a demographic bulge coming up. There'll be, for the next 20 years, there'll be steady increases in the numbers of people doing the Leaving Cert. The unnecessary heat was identified very clearly by Áine in the 190 arts and humanities options that Trinity provides. A bewildering array of programmes presented to 16, 17-year-olds, or maybe earlier in terms of their choice of subjects. And I think it doesn't serve the educational purpose very well. The Trinity document has an excellent emphasis on the importance of diversity and the value of diversity in educational settings. But Trinity's practices around admissions, I think, directly undermine the diversity that they achieve internally. And worst of all, from my perspective, is it undermines this intensive competition, undermines the diversity increasingly at second level, where we have the well-to-do families investing in grinds, private education and all that. And we know from international literature that diversity is absolutely critical for high-performing education systems as a whole, and we're in danger of severely undermining quality of Irish education more generally if we don't sort of get that balance right.
Joseph O'Grady.
If I could just take an opportunity first of all to say that there's no such thing as CAO points. It gets mentioned all the time, but it is a common point scale that's been adopted by the institutions and agreed since 1992, but it's not a requirement of participating in the CAO system. It's very transparent, clearly, and it does reflect what's coming out of the Leaving Certificate. And that's important because, as Mer said, and I'd agree with much of what he said there, some of what the Leaving Certificate is doing is examining the knowledge that's been gained by students over several years and then being used by considering people for application for entry to higher education. But there are other things that are not being measured by that, and I wonder if perhaps other types of tests might be used, not necessarily one you can study for, perhaps earlier in the cycle, and that those could be used by various different faculties in various different ways for consideration, various different types of courses. In other words, finding what people are good at by testing for it as opposed to examining rote learning.
So this would be not
be
necessarily a written test at all,
it
and it
various,
might be in the final
yes.
year or the final 2 years even.
Yeah, it could be various types of tests
okay.
used, but targeted at the skills or the types of motivation or the other types of things that were discussed this morning. It's a difficult one to do. I can imagine logistically there would be costs involved as well, but there would be other benefits to that. The student really at this stage would learn a little bit more about what they're good at and what they like doing, and that's something that is very, very important, and particularly in the current situation with the changes to guidance provision, that's going to impact on applicants. On students, on in making their decisions, in understanding what they're good at and what they'd like to do. Georgina raised this issue this morning, that applicants become students at higher education and then drop out because they don't have information about their courses. They also need information about themselves. What do I really want to do? And that's something that they could learn much earlier in the cycle. Another area we really need to remember that there are many, many routes of entry to higher education. Most of them are dealt with through the CAO system, and the HEAR and the DARE schemes have been particularly successful in recent years, getting national recognition at this stage, and award winning even. And those schemes have had a huge amount of success, and they are very, very focused on dealing with the educational disadvantage due to socioeconomic disadvantage or impact of disabilities. And that's another important one not to forget, that those routes of entry are there, and it's not simply people at the fringes, are people who, as you mentioned earlier, are close to getting in but don't make it, and then they're the extra 10 or whatever. There's large numbers of people coming in through those schemes, and they're having significant change to the position they would have been in had the schemes not been in place. So that's a major step that most higher education institutions have been involved in, and more are coming in to these schemes as well. I'd be interested to know if there are any results from the expert group into the HPAT test and entry to medicine. Can we find out, has the HPAT been a success in measuring what it was intended to measure? Because if we can find out a little bit about that, I think that could also be used to consider this type of test or tests at second level that all people could take and see if they can measure the things that the HPAT says it measures. It is something that I wouldn't like to see proliferation of tests where there would be extra costs to potential applicants and where people then would have to close off their choices too early as well. So that's something that perhaps should be provided at second level as part of the curriculum and part of the testing mechanism and then subsequently used by potential applicants.
Have you any concerns? I mean, it was certainly the case 30 or 40 years ago that second level was totally shaped mainly by third level minds, but as if its only function was to funnel people into third level at a time when precious few were getting through that gate. So now that the figures of going into third level are so much higher, that's a bit less of an issue. But at the same time, second level needs to sing its own song, doesn't it? And to bring forward the appropriate education with an appropriate certificate for those who are not going into third level.
Certainly, and as well as that, coming out of second level when you reach the end of second level in Ireland, there are lots of other opportunities, and it's not all directed just towards entry to higher education. Those who do the traditional leaving cert, only 4 out of 5 of those apply to go to higher education, and many of those may well come back to higher education later on, having gone through the scenic route, I think Áine mentioned earlier on, of doing further education, training, etc., perhaps work and come back in as FETAC applicants or mature applicants, and there's plenty of opportunity later on if people haven't come straight through from second level into higher education.
Okay.
Higher education also needs to remember that selection does have a major backwash effect on what happens in secondary schools as well.
Of course, yeah. Lewis Purser.
I'd like to make 2 points in the debate at this stage, and one is directly linked to your question to Joe, John. The question was asked earlier, is the leaving certificate a school leaving exam or a third level entrance exam? And the reality is it has to be both at this stage. If 4 out of 5 leaving certificate people who sit the leaving certificate are entering higher education, then it's effectively universal. And while there may be 1 out of 5 who isn't coming in, in many cases they've applied, but they don't actually come in, or they're doing something else, and they will come in at a later stage. So it has to serve both purposes, and the schools need to be quite certain that it's serving their purpose optimally. If necessary, higher education can put in additional measures to serve their purposes, but if it doesn't serve the school's purpose, then we're sunk, and I'm not sure it's serving the school purposes terribly well at the moment, and hence the reforms that are underway. The second point I'd like to make is that even if we in higher education sat back and did nothing for the next 5 years, I think we're going to be faced with some difficult choices, because it's one of the action points coming out of the HEA and the NCCA's report to the minister before Christmas, and it was mentioned again by Sean O'Fallou this morning. They're planning to change the leaving certificate grading system. Now, back of an envelope calculations with Joe and with a couple of other people around the table show that that's going to have major effects on how final decisions are made by universities on actually which students get into which courses, because currently we have 5-point differentials between students, and therefore small numbers of students coming in and looking to study course X in institution Y on point score Z. Now, if the grading system is changed, we're going to have at least 3 times the number of students X coming in to study course Y, etc. And nobody from the parent to Joe Duffy to the Minister for Education to the President or the Provost of Trinity College Dublin likes random selection. So if we don't reintroduce random selection, we're going to have to introduce another level of granularity about how we differentiate between that threefold increase of students on the same number of points. We're going to know a bit more about this in due course, because the CEO has very kindly agreed to the university's request to do a bit of a study using some existing data sets to see how the changes in grading systems could pan out. And Joe will have that, well, certainly for some initial stuff over the summer. But I think we need to, it's going to happen, and we're going to have to introduce a bit more granularity anyway. So let's start thinking about it seriously.
And what instruments would you use to
well,
give the final
you could introduce any number. You
yeah.
could say, okay, we've instead of having five students on the same number of point, the cutoff points for law, now we've got 15 or 20 or 30, and we can't take them all. So what are we going to do? Do we add additional subject conditionality as to which subjects they must have studied at which level of the Leaving Certificate?
That's a strong argument for that, isn't there?
Precisely, but then...
There's a lot of emphasis, by the way, in the responses that came in on these A4 pages for that the weighting of the subject in the Leaving Cert that was closest to the subject being, that should be some way of measuring that.
Or do you introduce something like Áine was suggesting earlier? Do you say, in order to study some subjects, it'd actually be a good idea if you'd taken a year out between your Leaving Certificate and your university, the start of your university studies, and done something interesting or relevant, or travelled or broadened your mind, or just grown up a little bit, or whatever. That you could imagine that Brendan was recommending, you know, there wouldn't be one way to skin this cat. For computer science might be a very different solution to history.
Okay. Jim Murray.
I suppose the main thing I've learned from the discussion today is that there's a big tension between the institutional and societal imperatives when it comes to admissions. I think it's interesting that this discussion has taken place largely amongst educationalists, whether they're in institutions, in agencies or government departments that are involved in educational policy. But whether we like it or not, it seems to me, and this isn't reflecting my own personal views, the great Irish public, to a large extent, likes the current system because of its predictability and because of perceived transparency and fairness. And there would be real nervousness around tinkering with the system. That said, it's not a view that I particularly share myself. I think there are serious issues now around the impact of the CAO, the points as allocated by institutions to Leaving Cert results for the purposes of admission, and the effect that they are having on the entire education and training system. And I think there's a lot of dishonesty around this whole discussion, particularly around what points actually reflect. While we all say it is to do with supply and demand and around quotas and so forth, the reality is that in the institutions, points are actually used to make value judgments on student capacity to fulfill the requirements of those courses. But given that, those points allocations and the scores that are allocated, they're very, very, very crude. And one of the issues that I'd like to see addressed, and it came up for me in a past life when I, way back in the midst of the time I used to work in Dublin City University, I remember the dot-com bubble burst. At that very time in DCU, I remember there was a new computing building and a much increased requirement that the university would bring in more computer application students. And because of the dot-com burst, we didn't get the application, so we were left with a building, and the points really plummeted through the floor. And what was interesting around that, we were saying, well, we must actually say that the minimum entry requirements that are on the system actually are not the minimum entry requirements. That really what we want is something between what we had hoped would be the cutoff points and the minimum entry points, and something in the middle. And I think we actually need to look at all programs in higher education and actually make some real effort to try and define what sort of Leaving Certificate achievement is actually required to ensure that a student is able to successfully participate on a program. So do you need 600 points or 585 or whatever, 590, to successfully complete a medicine course? I don't know. but no one is ever able to tell me what is actually required. But what it certainly doesn't appear to be are the minimum, the official minimum entry requirements that are in all the literature. I was talking to a professor of history from this August institution at lunchtime, and we're both historians, and we were talking about how, you know, if we had our Leaving Cert results now, we'd never get into pure history in Trinity now. And we're not bad historians, you know. we actually, you know, we're reasonably good in a very abstruse area, 16th century political and religious history. And we were actually just doing our lunch, trying to work out what would you really need in Leaving Certificate to have a, you know, a good shot at succeeding in the program. And you can do this exercise, and all the different subject experts can start doing this when they go home tonight. What would you actually need to successfully participate on a program? I think we weren't able to say it definitively. We didn't work out the actual points, but we know that they're lower than what is actually used in the CAO for the cut-off points. And it seems to me that if we could actually define what is actually needed for successful participation, we might then be able to sort of throw a grenade into the points race. And actually, we would end up with certain courses being way oversubscribed, but then we might be able to bring in those additional measures at that point. So maybe you only really need 350, I don't know, 400 for medicine, whatever. But if we could do something like that, then you could bring in other metrics. Maybe we should have three first choices on the CAO, and that if all the courses are way oversubscribed, there is random allocation to institutions at that point, and then the additional measures. But this supply and demand issue is it's so dishonest. It really is dishonest. It is fair, but to be putting sort of false leaving certificate achievement levels against programs is just wrong. And that's the point that the provost made this morning. We do know that there are students who don't get into programs who would be superb on those programs, just as we know that high points achievers on particular programs are not suitable for those programs once they get onto it. So if we could at least sort of throw a few grenades into the system, I think
throwing grenades in is easy, but how would you fix it? I mean, what would you do?
I would actually insist that all institutions, this is now me being God, would actually undertake an exercise where they actually had to work out for their programs what is the level of Leaving Certificate achievement required to successfully participate on the program, and maybe use those as the initial cutoffs. Then look at a lot of the additional measures that will be required that we use to assist in the admissions process. This would require a huge reinvestment of resources in institutions, and maybe my most radical and controversial suggestion, maybe we might be able to top slice some money off research budgets and invest it in this area.
Okay. Anne Looney. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Will. I've just learned that people who study 16th century religious history can use the word dishonest and fair in the same sentence. excellent achievement. So I'm just going to maybe just go back to Murch's point about Leaving Certificate reform, which is obviously it been quite an ongoing theme in the course of the day. And I suppose make three points. The first is the conundrum, just to summarise the conundrum that we've arrived at now, which is that nobody argues with the need for Leaving Certificate reform and for widening the modalities of that reform. And Murch has given us good examples of some of the things like portfolio and project work, which are in some Leaving Certificate subjects and being more widely introduced, and the need to reduce that predictability piece. And we're all in that space of saying that is a good thing, and that can only help the quality of the student experience, and can also in some way perhaps begin to reward initiative and the other kind of features of student achievement we want to value. But the conundrum is that while the heat of the points race is on, and while the burden of university entrance and selection is being carried by the leaving certificate, doing those kind of reforms becomes extremely difficult. Ironically enough, the critique of the leaving certificate, that it is not delivering what we need for higher education, and I put that in inverted commas, actually arises because it has to deliver for higher education. And so it becomes incredibly difficult, let's say, to deal with something like predictability because of the weight that the leaving certificate has to carry. And my colleague already mentioned, because of that pressure, understandably, people will game the system. I think that phrase that was used, Áine used at the Transitions Conference, people will use whatever advantage and resources they can to game the system when the stakes are high. And if we take
Isn't that also part of life as well?
Absolutely. But we have some choices.
That's a skill in a way. I know. I'm not.
It is.
Yeah.
In fact, maybe people should be rewarded for it.
Hmm.
But if we found a way to measure that, I'm sure we could get points for it. But predictability is a really good example, because the Joe Duffy factor arises in here. So within the State Examinations Commission, and someone will have to explain to visitors who Joe Duffy is, actually. But I mentioned this.
He's former president of the Students' Union here, and I was throwing out some clippings last night, actually, trying to get rid. And I came across this interview with Joe Duffy, 30 years ago. Sorry, but I won't go there anymore.
I serve in student politics with Joe myself, actually. But predictability is an interesting one, because every time there is an attempt to make a part of the leaving certificate unpredictable and to surprise students and to put in the tricky question or the one that causes for independent thinking, there's a public outcry. And it's not just, and the Provost made a point this morning, which is it's not just a media outcry, it's a public one. The language around it is the language of emotion. So you can actually have a headline that says, students were traumatised by question 5. I don't mean to be flippant about it, but it's the weight of expectations, the weight that of question 5, the degree of preparation they've put into question 5, and we don't change question 5. And I was ready for this, and you put in this in the interest of trying to catch me out. Now, some level of predictability in examinations is actually necessary. You do need some stability. Students do need to be able to prepare, but we also need to be able to look at how you can measure initiative. So that's a conundrum. While the leaving certificate has to carry the weight of university entrance, I think reform becomes very difficult. The second issue on point I want to make is about the grading change, which Lewis flagged. Don't underestimate that grading change discussion, as I suppose for me it's almost become a symbol of second level reclaiming the leaving certificate for itself. Because in a way, by perhaps widening those grades and going maybe not fully back to where we were 20 or 30 years ago, but by saying we're not going to grade to the level of percentage granularity we're doing now, it is about trying to bring the exam back into the purposes of second level. And maybe it is about coming back to what it might be. And to flag that it is being explored with some international experts in the area of examination and grading. It's not something you do on the back. I know you can do research. I don't say you can do research on the back of an envelope, but you can model it on the back of an envelope. But to do it, it requires a certain amount of care. And the third point I want to make is just the broader societal one. I read a paper recently, I'm afraid I can't remember the author, but he used the example of considering universities and university admissions. And he said, it's an interesting scenario to get a group of people in a university thinking about admissions to imagine that all the students outside who are in the college are replaced by all the students who didn't get in. So that all the students who got through that little narrow gate are now outside, and all the students who didn't get into Trinity have actually made it in. How would the debate be different? And that caused a lot of discussion. And then somebody in the room said, well, whatever about the debate, it'd be fixed by Monday. which is probably the broader issue around the intractable problems of power and control. And probably one of the reasons why debates like this go on for so long has to do with the nature of society itself and who benefits from education and who succeeds. And a bit like Stephen's model of we probably find it easier to do the marginal change than to give up the advantage and to really make the very radical change and say, actually, we'll open law or whatever faculty it is on an entirely different rate. I suspect whatever the equivalent is, Joe Duffy would be hopping if you took Stephen's suggestion. So.
Yeah. And do you believe that as a society now, that there is, because somebody made this point earlier, that we're ready, this is a moment when change might be possible?
I do, because and I agree with Jim's point, there is a lot of confidence in the points system and in the CAO, but actually people are beginning to use phrases like fair and dishonest in the same sentence now, and not just Jim. But equally, we've people like Stephen and others who talk about what success means in industry and what success means in life, and increasingly we're starting to see, and possibly the economic failure has helped us to do that it is resilience and problem solving and creative thinking that are beginning to help us to see that perhaps reproducing what we always have reproduced, we're now at the point where we might actually begin to think about doing it differently.
But you say there's lots of confidence in the point system. If you started to try and change it, all hell would break loose as well, wouldn't it?
I'm probably talking about leaving certificate reform. I don't think, to be fair, people are talking about changing the points system. What we're talking about is how do you reform the leaving certificate in the way we want it to reform, look at the needs of university admissions, look at the relationship between the two of those things. And I think people are talking about looking at reconfiguring that, and I think there's some interesting suggestions coming up.
Okay. Sean O'Reilly is there with the roving microphone. Yes, we've contribution here. Yeah.
Good afternoon, Sam Heelan here from AHEAD. If you don't know who we are, we kind of represent students with disabilities. And it's just we are talking about a system that for those particular group of students, it is unfair. Because students, for example, who are blind or deaf, are four times less likely to make the transition into higher education. And it's not because they haven't the smarts or the ability. It's actually about, and it's not just the Leaving Cert, but it's the backwash from the Leaving Cert and that examination into second level, which means that, you know, their education is affected. So, you know, even a minor thing like the examination, they cannot do it electronically, they cannot use even a computer in an exam. So these kind of things are made very difficult for them. So there are inherent unfairness in the system for a certain cohort of Irish students, which I think the Leaving Cert perpetuates, if you like. It's not doing anything about it. So, I mean, we would be looking for changes in the Leaving Cert and to how assessment is made, because the reality is if you want to bring in all the skills that employers are looking for, the creativeness and the problem solving and all of those other skills, you really cannot be assessing them by an exam which assesses a completely other different skill set. So I think there is a really strong argument here for some sort of reform of the Leaving Cert that would include continuous assessment or whatever else it is. But I think it's just to remind people that there are a cohort of students out there for whom the current system isn't serving, and it does need to change.
Thank you for that. Yes, just the back row.
Thanks, John Walsh, School of Education here in Trinity. Firstly, I'd just like to strongly support the call made by the previous speaker for a reform of the assessment and the Leaving Cert. I think perhaps in some contributions that were made today, people talk about learning and assessment as if they're separate things, and of course they're not. Assessment is a core part of learning. And much of the intense pressure and competition at second level comes not only from the pressure of third level entry, which is very real, but also from the nature of the Leaving Cert as a predominantly once-off assessment. And any Leaving Cert reform needs to reform the nature of the Leaving Cert as an assessment. And I fully realise that the problems of continuous assessment, and there are problems of project work, there's problems of continuous assessment, but it shouldn't be beyond the ingenuity of policymakers and indeed of institutions to come up with forms of a more graduated assessment, which reduce the pressure on students and which change the nature of the Leaving Cert as a highly pressurised once-off assessment. I think, just to make a second point, there's also a challenge for institutions in the nature of the first-year experience. And certainly, the first year in university needs to be seen as much more of a year of transition than it currently is. I would raise the question as to why we need to have exams in first year, why we need to have the level. I believe that students are over-assessed, particularly under modular and semesterized systems, which are brought in for the very good reason of making money and bringing in international students, in my view. Now, I'm not suggesting we reopen that debate, but there is a serious issue of over-assessment, and I think that needs to be addressed, particularly in first year. Universities need to look in radical ways at changing the nature of their assessment, while at the same time making it easier for students to transfer, to engage in course transfer, to move from one course to the other. Regardless of what reform...
And just from your own experience, what have you... I don't particularly want you to mention case histories or anything, but what proportion of students, in your view, would benefit from having a more open first year where they're learning skills but they're not yet focused on what their final degree might be?
I'm not sure I'd give a percentage, but I think that the very large majority would benefit from a more open first year where critical thinking can be developed, where there's scope for independent learning, and where there isn't the pressure of a first year examination, which tends merely to replicate the pressures and incentives imposed by the Leaving Cert in the previous year or 2 years before.
And literacy as well could be emphasised, couldn't it? I mean, a lot of people who come through the system, their skills at writing and communicating what they want to say on the page to the reader,
yeah,
without ambiguity,
there's
slipping.
There's certainly issues around that. And first year is also the place where the largest problems with non-progression arise, where people tend to drop out.
Yeah.
But if I just, I don't want to take up too much time, just to make a final point on course transfer. Georgina spoke very eloquently this morning. I think it's important that we allow a greater degree of mobility across institutions in course transfer. So that if someone finds that, you know, they've been in a course for 3 months and it's fundamentally the wrong course for them, it's relatively easy for them to transfer across institutions as well as within them. And that, you know, the dropout is not seen as a failure. And I wouldn't underestimate the trauma involved in dropout, but if someone leaves a course which they weren't enjoying, in which they won't be able to make a contribution to society, to the college, that's not a failure. In the long term, it's very good for their personal development.
Do you think we have a problem around language? I mean, the word dropout is a very negative term, isn't it? It's very negative.
I think it's an atrocious term.
Yeah.
And as I say, I wouldn't underestimate the trauma involved.
I mean, we've omitted the word failure from the whole exam system now. You know, people achieve a certain amount. They don't fail. So I think the word dropout should be, it's a casual word. I know we all use it, but it may not be fair.
But equally, we need to deal with the issues behind it.
Yeah, of course, yes, yeah. Yes.
Just a couple of points.
Microphone coming, yeah.
And Áine was talking about predictability and going back to the Leaving Cert, I just want to make two quick points. But one, I think, is it's a bit like Donald Rumsfeld, but there's predictable unpredictability and there's unpredictable unpredictability. And I think the Leaving Cert needs a significant element of predictable unpredictability. Like in the Irish examination, 40% has been brought in for Oral Irish, which I totally support. And I think something similar in a lot of subjects would be appropriate to bring that, the creativity and the wisdom and those other things which are very much important. The other point I'd like to make, though, is about there's a suggestion that there should be subjects that are specific to the course and that they would inform the decision. And that in some sense sounds good, but I've just come across some recent work down in Cork looking at economics marks in third year and seeing was there any correlation between people who did economics for the Leaving Certificate and their performance in third year economics. And it's interesting that it's inversely correlated. there's also an inverse correlation, by the way, between performance in economics and students who do go to grind schools. I think that's also interesting. So I think a bit more information would be useful on those types of, now that's just one study, but it'd be useful to get similar studies.
Yes.
Here, just in the middle of the here. Yeah.
Billy Kelly, GCU. I think we're putting too much weight on the central linchpin in all of this, which is about admissions. And we know that the CAO admissions system creates problems in second level. And now we're looking at this to, in some sense, we're talking about predictability. And we have to be careful what it is we want to predict. Universities should be very, very confident about their abilities in the formation of students. The Leaving Cert shouldn't be about predicting how it is students are going to perform at the end of their university life on graduation. And in some sense, I think that was the focus of the Points Commission, which was to look at how students performed at the end. And Áine Hyland made the point that the Leaving Cert is a very good predictor. But I think we have to take that apart. It's not a good predictor. For first year of work that I know that was done in DCU, Leaving Cert points predict about 10% of the variation in first year performance. Put another way, 90% of the variation that we see in first year performance cannot be explained by looking back at Leaving Cert points. Now part of that is because of the way that we select students. And what happens when you have a cutoff point is the vast majority of students are coming in on points very close to that cutoff point. Yet what we do is we're able to assess these students at the end of the year and scatter them all the way from first class honours through non-completion. So I think what you do is, if the Leaving Cert is not a good predictor, you address the problem. I think that what started this issue was the effect on second level. And I think there's a sense in which the third level sector should solve its problems and leave the second level system to solve its problems and try to create a system where there is as little impact as possible. The fundamental problem here is that students have to acquire points through the Leaving Cert process. And we know that students and more importantly perhaps parents will game any system that was there. HPAT wasn't a week out and there were grind schools in Dublin offering courses in HPAT. And that's the reality of it. And there's many parents, and there are parents in this room who would sell a kidney for their children. And that's the way of the world. So you pick a selection system that has as little impact as possible on the second level system. Now, if we take an example from what Professor Sternberg talked about this morning, say something like a kaleidoscope kind of thing, where students are doing an essay. Will students gain this? Yes, they will. Will schools gain this? Yes, they will. But it won't have this fundamental impact. And the problem with the CAO system is the tentacles go back from sixth year into fifth year into transition year, right the way back into the system. And I think any system that we have will create adverse behaviour. And what we do is we choose the least worst one rather than trying to find the holy grail of the best one.
Okay, thank you for that. Yes, just behind you there. Yeah.
Thank you. I found the entire discussion both this morning and this afternoon really wide-ranging and fascinating. But I particularly agree with the speaker behind me who talked about the link between assessment and learning and how we often treat it quite separately. The other thing that struck me is that the predictive, I mean, we're asking an awful lot of the admission system and we're asking different things of it. So predictive validity is one thing we're looking for, but we're also looking for fairness. And fairness is not the same as predictive validity. And I think we need to make sure that we recognise that we've got to deconstruct the kinds of expectations we have about the admissions process. I also think that it's been enormously satisfying to hear more references to the broad purposes and value systems associated with education. It's not something I was expecting to hear as much of as I have today, and I think that's really very important. You know, what do we mean by education at all levels? And for me, it's helping people to find their purpose and their pleasure in life in a way that fits with their skills and allows them to fulfill their potential. We know, and other people have heard me talk about this before, but that in order to become a really brilliant expert in something, you have to spend 10,000 hours of practice. Everyone's heard this 10,000 rule, the 10-year rule. And what are you most likely to spend time, at that amount of time doing? You're most likely to spend that amount of time doing something you love doing. And so learning a love of something is fundamental. I often think that the Leaving Cert points are a very poor proxy for motivation, for that real love of something. And it's the only proxy we have at the moment, and maybe, as many people have said, it's more serviceable than others. But we do have, we do at a time when teachers are under fire at all levels, we have an awful lot to ask of our teachers, and it's about helping people to find this pleasure and purpose in life. And what I fear, and I've heard this from a number of different people today, is that that the Leaving Cert points becomes the label that you bring with you throughout life. I've heard Anne Looney talk about this before, that it's people develop theories about themselves very early on in life. I'm not good at maths, is something that a lot of people say, and Anne has very eloquently spoken about this before. And you know, it seems to be almost acceptable to say that you're not good at maths in a way that you wouldn't be able to say about other types of subjects, and yet this is one of the most important subjects we need to pursue. But I'm not good at maths is a theory that people don't get by themselves. They often get it from their teachers. And they get it from their teachers because it's very difficult to teach maths. And we have an awful lot to ask of our maths teachers. That's just one example. I mean, I also draw from the educational theorists on expertise who say that they started out looking for exceptional students. And what they found when they looked at performance were exceptional circumstances. And it's our job as educators to create exceptional circumstances in very difficult conditions, I understand that, but I think that there are possibilities now and technologies and innovations that we could engage in that that I think are really important for us to look at now. So I guess the admissions debate has always got to have the purpose of education in its mind. It's got to understand the different political forces that are pulling it in various different directions, and the focus on teaching and learning and the student experience has got to be central.
Yes. Sorry, I'll take first and then Bridget.
Derek O'Byrne, Registrar at Waterford Institute of Technology. Just a couple of very quick points. Firstly, a lot of the discussion has kind of highlighted, and normally when we see in the media, the discussion highlights around a small number of very high-point profile courses. The reality of the distribution of points is that the bubble is actually much further down. It's at the 350, 450 point scale. And it's those students who very often are making the most difficult decisions and have got the greatest spectrum, if you like, of choices to make. And with the new changes, the proposed changes to the point system, that bubble is going to get actually larger. So it's there where I think the real punch is going to come. And linked to that, I think we also have talked a lot today about some of the behavioural disconsequences of the current CAO system. But we haven't thought about the behavioural issues of the admission systems itself. So, for instance, were we to bring in a greater extent of interaction with the student, we're actually engaging the student much quicker or at a much faster pace in the institution, in the curriculum, and so on. And we're actually getting feedback from the learner in terms of our own processes, but also they're learning about the institution. And that should fit or create a better fit between the learner and the institution. And a very simple thing that could happen, for instance, is in most other systems around the world, very often offers are made subject to marks being achieved. There's no reason why we couldn't shift and give offers subject to CAO points and decoupling CAO as the starting point for the admissions process and make it the ending point for the admissions process.
Okay. Microphone just here.
Bridget McManus, just 2 points I was going to make. One, while I would be very optimistic like Anne that the conditions are there, I think one of the real problems we have in Ireland in this space a huge bias against being wrong or being uncertain, in a sense. And somebody spoke this morning about the need to accept that if you devolve things, then some of the decisions, you know, will be kind of errors. And we get into this with the assessment. There's a there's an acceptance if people do interviews for a job or something that they can actually, it's the luck on the day or something, but the there's a huge resistance to something that isn't completely certain, and it's the exact same in one school in the north as in the north of the country as a school in the south. And I think if we're to be serious, and I find it quite frightening in the debate on junior cert reform, and junior cert is not a high stakes exam, for there's very few people don't go on to do leaving certificate. The degree to which that need for certainty, consistency beyond the point of what's being reasonable seems to dominate the discourse. And I think if we're to be serious about this area, you have to accept that there's more variability, and that the price, the real benefit of that more variability is actually a better school system and education system. And we kind of need in the society debate get into that. There's just one other brief point to make that I thought a bit about in some of the debate about the socioeconomic issue. It applies to the admissions, but it also applies to kind of coursework and assessment. Is the very right fear we have of doing things that give certain socioeconomic groups an advantage. But there are certain things you have to do for the education. I mean, if you look at orals, for example, the issue arises if you make oral for a continental modern language, a very big part of the marks, are you advantaging people whose kids can go abroad and get more French or German or Spanish? And yet at the end of the day, if you're going to measure competence in a language, you know, it has to be oral competence. So I think at some point there's a trade-off that you have to accept that it's the right form of assessment or the right form of measurement, even if there is a socioeconomic issue, and correct it somewhere else. And I think there is a bit of a balancing act we're going to have to do in all kinds of assessment. It arises in different forms of assessment, we talked about them this morning, but it arises if you talk about project work or you talk about the leadership in organisations, is it the kids from better socioeconomic backgrounds? And there is going to be a trade-off there, there isn't an easy answer, so I just make that point as well.
Okay, Patrick, I think you want to make contact with Dr. Sternberg again. Dr. Sternberg, we're watching you disrobe and make yourself comfortable. Are you hearing us in Dublin?
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, there. You hear me? Uh-oh.
We can hear you. The picture is frozen like 2 days ago, but we can't hear you.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know why the picture keeps freezing.
It's frozen on a good shot.
Okay.
We wanted to ask you a particular question because it was raised that one of the criticisms of the current system in Ireland is that it can be coached, that these what we call grind schools can be set up and people can pay to get coaching and training. So could that happen with Rainbow or Kaleidoscope or Panorama? If we would have something like that as one element, is there a danger that the rich could benefit, get a coach and poor children would lose out?
Sure. There's certainly a chance that people would try to coach it. Whether it would be successful is another question. But first, let me say hello to everybody, and thank you for giving me the chance to speak with you. I visited Dublin a few years ago and had a great trip and thought it would be wonderful to live there, but thought that without a job, I hear the jobs there are not plentiful, and we have 1.25-year-old triplets who we need to get the money to send them to Trinity. There afterward, an opportunity arose, namely that one of your large beer and stout companies that will go unnamed, but that makes my favorite stout, had a contest where you could write a jingle. And if you had the winning jingle, you had the chance to compete to own a pub in Dublin, which would be given to you for free. And I thought that this was my great chance to move to Dublin. So I not only submitted one, but two jingles, which I can modestly say were creative, brilliant, really just what they should have wanted. And neither one was chosen, so I didn't get the pub. And at that point, I became very concerned with how evaluation of creative work is being done in Ireland. I, such innovative jingles which were unappreciated. So I'm really glad to be here today to talk about this in the hope that next time they have a jingle contest, I will be successful and I will own that pub and you'll all come to buy my beer. In the meantime, the coaching is difficult, and I'll say why. The first thing is that the kinds of essays we use are ones that often parents or coaches would not write as good an essay as a kid would. So the topics are really oriented toward kids, like the end of MTV. Some parents don't know what that is, or the professor disappeared, or the mysterious lab. We really try to choose topics that are more contemporary for younger people. So one thing is whether parents or coaches would be in a position to write a better essay. The second issue is that for creative work, it's really hard to directly coach. The reason is that it's judged for two things. One is novelty or originality, and the other is quality. And if a coaching company or other organization were to say, this is the way you should write these essays, then those would become less novel and then would be graded down. So it's really hard to tell people do this for creativity on any large scale, because that in itself increases the frequency of the responses and makes them less original. So that's the second thing. The third thing is that the essays change every year. So one thing you can't do is have a store of old essays and build up a sort of file of cute answers, because the next year the essays will be different. But that said, you know, to the extent that people are coaching you to write better or to draw better or whatever, well, those are the kinds of things you want students to do anyway, and those wouldn't be such bad outcomes. I, by the way, with the picture, you probably think it's frozen, but I have a frozen head syndrome, and that's actually the way I look all the time. Let's get out of that pose.
Final question, Dr. Sternberg. Is there any, what in terms of best practice, what countries or states in countries would you suggest that people in this room examine with regard to admission policy in third level?
Yeah, I don't think that there are, I don't think that generally what we're doing in admissions is so good anywhere that I've been. When I was at Tufts, we introduced the Kaleidoscope Project, and I think you've heard my brief description of it. I'm not sure, but in the,
yes.
In a video, so I hope you heard it. Here we're doing panorama, so, and those are described in more detail in my book, College Admissions for the 21st Century, which as you leave the auditorium, I'll be selling with a deluxe leather-bound cover and gold leaf bookmark. So I hope you'll purchase them from me. But seriously, I think that admissions is something where we kind of have to start again, because what we've been doing is measuring things that are not the kinds of things that are make our, that are going to make our societies better. If you look at our societies, whether it's in Europe or North America, the problem is not that we don't have enough smart people. We have a lot of smart people. The problem, it's very easy to think of smart leaders. As I might have said in my video, I don't remember, in the United States, we have one candidate with one degree from Harvard, another candidate with two degrees from Harvard. I mean, you know, they're smart. What's hard to find in the world today is wise and ethical leaders and people who are creative in breaking out of deadlocks. I mean, right now in the United States, we have a Congress that seems determined to do as little as, I better not say that, I might be extradited out of the country. But a Congress is not doing a lot. And so I think we need to be doing university admissions to provide the leaders who are going to make the world a better place. And that's not going to happen through achievement tests on high school curriculum or so-called aptitude tests that don't really measure aptitudes. I think we have to start over. And what I've suggested we do is look for the kinds of active citizenship and ethical leadership qualities that will produce the kind of leaders that our world really needs and that we seem to have very few of.
Thank you very much indeed for joining us twice today.
Thank you very much.
Okay, well, thank you. And don't forget to let me win.
Don't forget what?
I want to win that pub.
Okay. In the meantime, his book is available, I know, from the usual sources, i.e. sort of Amazon, and it is A College Admissions for the 21st Century, Dr. Robert Sternberg. Finally, can I just ask very briefly the panel here to give us their final views. Muiris O'Connor.
Thank you. It's been a very interesting discussion. As I said at the start, I think, and as Seán Fáilleadh said at the outset, this requires change on both sides of the transitions. And some of the points that stick with me now is, and I think the simple observation that
this is on, yeah.
The simple observation that people tend to be good at what they find interesting is something that we should really go with, but in a sense, so what that would mean basically is that the point system, which I think by and large is good, and I don't think Ireland has to look anywhere else, I think it's a refinement of the point system is what we need. If the point system could recognise through bonus points or whatever performance in cognate disciplines, I think that would be good. The problem is the inequality in access to higher level subjects and the inequalities in access to high quality facilities in second level. So I think we need to totally and utterly revisit and recommit ourselves to the concept of comprehensive second level education. I think we should ensure that all 12 to 18 year olds have access to the full range of subjects in flexible combinations. Now, you can imagine this is logistically, there'd be a whole rearrangement of second level, multi-campus second level institutions in any town. But ensuring that all children had access to a broad range of subjects and intelligences, as the Points Commission advised, and I think, reassured that that access existed, we could, I think, quite clearly express, and the academic community could, as Jim says, articulate the minimum entry requirements associated with the different faculties. On the higher education side, as articulated in the NCCA higher HEA recommendations, I think we need a refreshment of the undergraduate experience as well. And just, I can offer clarification that the internal Trinity document cast serious aspersions on what they regard as a generic, bland first year that might be imposed. And I can reassure Trinity and all other university people and colleges that that's not the intention at all. It was a sense that a broadening of entry to undergraduate provision would allow for a focus on the core underpinning competences and skills required. It's not intended to undermine the disciplinary specific content, and what we intended was additional teaching time in each academic year for students, and there's plenty of space for additional teaching time, the teaching
okay.
here in this institution.
Okay, Joseph O'Grady.
Well, it's been very interesting hearing all the various views that we've heard here today. I think I've learned an awful lot, and I would like to say that one of the strengths of the CAO system, and I don't mean the CAO company, but I mean the system, as in all of the institutions that participate in the system together. One of the strengths of that has been they work together to achieve much change over the last 35 years. Even in the last 10 or 15 years, we've seen an awful lot of change. There's a whole stream, several streams of different types of people coming through into the CAO system, into higher education, not all school leavers. I know we're talking mostly about school leaving here today. And that the system is flexible enough to embrace change. And it's flexible enough to come up with change, and working together, I believe the CAO institutions can do that. On a personal note, I wonder about an awful lot of the skills that are sought, both at higher education and by employers. I wonder if the subject of philosophy should be considered at second level. I think it would meet an awful lot of the needs, and it also is a subject that engages students, but that's a bit of a big job to introduce a subject out of the blue, but I think it would introduce an awful lot of assistance to students.
Okay, Lewis Purser.
Two topics that we didn't mention today, but I'd like to throw in briefly at the end. One is, I personally, but we haven't discussed at all the issue of the numerous courses in higher education for which the leaving certificate is only part of the process of getting in. All the creative arts and performing arts, but not exclusively creative and performing arts. There are other courses too for which a certain minimum leaving certificate result is required, but then there are other portfolio and other requirements that are there. And it would be really interesting to learn in much more detail how these operate, the success of them, can they identify the right students for the right courses, etc., and how they do that in a relatively painless and efficient way. The second thing is that many of the practicalities that we've bandied around a little bit and that might be nice to have in our current logistical setup are very difficult to operate, given that we get our Leaving Cert results sometime post 15th of April. And that
August.
So, excuse me, of course I meant August, sometime post 15th of August, and college term in most places starts on the 1st of September. That 2 week period is of high intensity. The CEO and admissions officers go into some sort of sealed box somewhere, and names and numbers and things spew out, and people are ecstatic or disappointed. But if that, and I mean, I look at the French system or the UK system or many other European systems, which are far larger and far more diverse and far more complicated, leaving school, end of school exams, and they can have the results out in early July. Why can't we? And that leaves a whole period of summer for students to reflect on how they did and what might be useful, what are their real options, and having achieved what they have achieved, how they might refine. It would leave space for institutions to say, okay, we've got an effective cutoff point of such a level. Now we've got a cohort which is too big for the size we can take with. Now we're going to put you through an additional interview or weight your specific subjects or whatever it is to define which students are actually best fitted for that course. And it would allow a lot of other refinements in place, which frankly currently are not logistically possible either for institutions or for students and their families.
Okay, thank you for that. Jim Murray?
Thank you. I suppose just in summary, I think all systems, unless they're re-looked at and reviewed and evaluated and considered, I mean, they will fossilize. And I think we probably have come to that periodic time where the timeline is, but every 10, 15 years where we really do need to look again and be creative in terms of the admission systems that we're using. I would echo Lewis's point to bring more creativity into the system and to allow time to develop more creative admission systems. We certainly need to work towards gearing the Leaving Certificate system and the results to come in earlier in the year.
Thanks very much. So as you've gone down the table, we've got to introduce a comprehensive system at second level, philosophy at second level, get the Leaving Certificate done quicker, multiply by two. So just I'll say something about university admissions, if that's okay. in fairness, just one point about the Leaving Cert resulting and something about the Leaving Certificate that's different from other examinations, which is that precisely because it offers a broad range of subjects, you have students who can take combinations of subjects, which means that papers have to be scheduled separately. So while you may hear that students are taking their examinations in at the beginning of June, there are students taking examinations right to the end of June, and you can't result until those students have finished and their papers have gone through the same process. So just in terms of how it is, yes, of course, there are options of running it within school time, and you can explain that to the Mammies of Ireland, why their students are taking the subjects while the rest of the school is still running. It could be extremely difficult. So just, it is different in A level. You're talking about 3-4 subjects, so it is a little bit. It is a little bit different. Where was I? Oh, university admission. That's it. the point I want to make is this one. Bridget made a really interesting point about trade-offs, and that is that if you move to in Leaving Certificate reform to introduce different kinds of assessments and examinations, and you introduce a measure of uncertainty. In other words, if you move towards greater validity, you know what the trade-off is. So what I would say, I suppose, to those who are involved in the higher education sector and in the business of university admissions, as we attempt from both sides of the Grand Canyon to deal with the conundrum, is that as we begin to move towards reforms, that we look towards leadership in the higher education sector and in the second level sector to inform the public debate on this issue. Because very often the public debate is ill-informed and uncertainty is bad for my child. And this kind of tinkering with the system is bad. It's dumbing down, you know, all the kind of things, the things that land in my inbox every day. So we do require, in informing public debate, that leaders within the education system, in higher education, in education departments, university registrars, admissions officers, people working in all kinds of the, right across the sector, contribute to that debate, to informing it. And Áine used several times in her presentation, informing it with evidence and with good research, and moving beyond anecdote, which inevitably reduces to the sample size of one, which is my experience and my child. And I think when we're at this business, it is about all children and looking at, across the system as a whole.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think on that point, by the way, that the best medium for that debate, where education should contribute, is radio, because it's pervasive, it returns to subjects like this. It's a very important subject. And a lot of radio stations have a requirement to have 20% speech content. This is a debate which is absolutely, but you've got to get in there in an informed way, or it'll take off on the anecdote and the one parent complaining to one particular broadcaster whom I will not name, possibly getting a very good hearing. You know, so I remember once I was chairing a conference on food, and there was this middle manager from Marks and Spencer's. And he was extraordinarily good. He had absolutely encyclopedic knowledge about every product on their shelf, on their food shelf. And this farmer complained that their Marks were very welcome to Ireland, but did he know that Ireland was a producer of sheep meat and lamb, and that the lamb was New Zealand lamb on the Marks and Spencer's? And the answer came back. He said, look, we regard lamb as a seasonal product. After 6 months, it's hoggut. And so we get New Zealand for 6 months of the year in Irish. And you'll be pleased to know that we sold 37,000 tons of Irish lamb in our Paris outlet last year. Now, if this guy from Marks and Spencer's hadn't been there, and that man had phoned a radio program, he would be off and he'd have won but it was game, set, and match for the producer. It's just you need the information to hop into the debate. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, I'd like to thank John Bowman for chairing so brilliantly the last two sessions. You can really see the mark of a true broadcaster, a true professional. And also the fact that when we emailed him about this, he didn't hesitate to accept it. He put in a huge amount of work preparing information on the different panelists, and all he got for it in return was, I'm afraid, two sandwiches and a cup of coffee. So we're very grateful to Dr. John Bowman. Left to me to just sum up some of the things that were discussed today, but I'm not going to keep you from your glass of wine upstairs. One, I've been off my feet all week, and especially today. Two, I've actually even lost my shoes. So I'll just try and bring together some of these things. And one of the things that we are particularly proud of in Trinity is the fact that we do get students from all across the 32 counties and the 110 countries that Professor Schwartz mentioned. But those figures from our report that Professor Hyland quoted about the fact that we get a large proportion from a certain number of select feeder fee-paying schools, that's not something we're proud of. And that is something that we would like to change. And I think that's one of the reasons why we're addressing this. And we very much appreciate Muiris's concerns there about, could a radical change disadvantage people further? Could that be actually a weapon against those who are already socioeconomically disadvantaged? And we really do appreciate Muiris, not only for his contribution here today, but over the past, well, certainly since September, since I've been in this role, he's been always very generous with his time, with his advice, coming in to talk to us about documents, always there to listen to us. So we appreciate his concern. And if that was what a new system would lead to, then I don't think no one would want that. I started off in Trinity teaching on the Trinity Access Programme. I've continued with it 12 years. And I've seen it firsthand
just how much potential there is out there, just how much enthusiasm, just how many great people that were previously slipping through the net. But in a way, this debate isn't just about socioeconomic disadvantage. There's a lot of other people who slipped through the net because their abilities aren't just measured. And that's why I'd return to what the Provost said or what Brendan said about using different modalities, different data points, and trying to have a more fair system in that way. There was a lot of discussion about the development of generic skills, or using first year to develop these all-important skills, critical thinking skills, communication skills, and so on. And so that way, even if the student didn't continue past first year, they learned very important skills. But I would be very concerned about that, because I think the whole degree should be about those skills. I don't like the idea that in first year you learn communication skills and thinking skills and independent skills, but then in year two you're back to some boring form of knowledge and assessment, and years three and four or whatever. Because for me anyway, the curriculum should be about that the whole way through. And I think that's somewhere like the debate about assessment that John Walsh mentioned there, we've been having that internal debate here. We 2 weeks ago in this very room we had a faculty forum. Well, actually, we got people from all three faculties talking about assessment, another one in the Biomedical Sciences Institute yesterday, and one in the Lloyd building last week. And there you had people coming together, breaking into small groups, and sharing ideas about how we currently assess in innovative ways, and thinking, are there ways we can remove the obstacles? Because we do think that we want to develop broader skills. It goes on in some areas brilliantly, like in law with their moot trials and that counts. In dental science, they video the student in the fourth year dealing with a trial problem case, and then they give them feedback and they're assessed on that afterwards. You know, on Morning Ireland this morning, Professor Schwartz was asked about brain surgery. Colin McQuilla said, well, what about a brain surgeon? We don't care if the person was good at tennis or had a good personality or was involved in student clubs and societies. If a loved one, or if I'm going in for brain surgery, I just want a good brain surgeon. And I was listening outside and I was completely thrown by that. And I was thinking, okay. And Professor Schwartz, well, actually, I before my current role, I was involved in a dean of medicine. And in fact, we have looked at all of that, that to be a good brain surgeon, it's not just about being a good brain surgeon and knowing that, that you need a level of empathy, you need to be able to make human judgment calls, you need to be able to make decisions about things that will affect the patient's life, and that you need a broader range of skills for that, that are not just measured in one single thing. And I thought that was very significant. I think that Stephen McIntyre, who was on our working group and again made a brilliant contribution to it, completely exploded my suggestion about 10 places on a course, which I will say in my defense was intended as a thought piece rather than, but maybe that is something that we need to think about doing something maybe further across. And that, I suppose, brings me to my final point. Oh, actually, by the way, the producer of Morning Ireland came out at the end and turned to myself and Georgina and Professor Roy and said, I never really knew how bad the Leaving Cert and the points sit pressure was until this year, because this is the first year I have a child going through it, and that the level of stress is extraordinary. So I don't really think the public out there would be horrified if we decided to assess through different things, because anything that would remove the stress and pressure on the 60,000 or so students who are about to sit that exam in about 2 weeks' time, I think would be more than welcomed, certainly by the 60,000 and probably by their family and friends. So, but how can we move forward? Because I think there's no point in us just having had such a good discussion today and then nothing coming out of it, and that this time next year there's the same pieces talking about the problem. So one thing we'll do is, oh, and by the way, I'd really like to round of applause for Gary, our brilliant cinematographer and cameraman. We haven't seen the footage, but I'm sure it's going to be brilliant. But we are going to edit this footage and put it online on the website. We'll follow up with the attendees here. We're going to follow up on this. We'll follow up with the IOTI and the IUA and maybe produce a shorter document, a follow-up. We collected all of the comments that people produced in the first half, and we'll collate them and put them together, because this is something that we should move forward about, whether we should try and implement some of the suggestions from today, whether it is kaleidoscope and work with Professor Sternberg, whether it's that we should try a pilot, whether we should try something more radical, whether we should try it just in one institution, or whether we could do it across the entire sector. But certainly we'd work use the structure that's being provided by the IOTI and the IUA as a way of exchanging these documents and exchanging these ideas and putting up today's discussion on the web for more, and invite people who are here to email us with comments and suggestions and points, and email and invite people who weren't here to also contribute to this debate over the summer. And I'd like to give a special thanks to Lewis Purser and Ned Costello of the IUA, who really helped advise and shape the form of this symposium, this conference today. And a special thanks to Dr. Jim Murray, who met me for a chat at a time when we really weren't quite sure of how the format would go, and Jim gave so much good advice that it really helped put a shape on it. And I'm so particularly grateful, I'm going to break from a tradition of a lifetime and support Chelsea in the Champions League final tomorrow as a sign of gratitude to Jim. I still don't think they have a chance, but I'll support them. But I'll support them anyway. But all that remains for me then is just to thank everyone who contributed. Our two panels, John Bowman again, all the people who took part in earlier, Professor Áine Hyland, who we'll be honouring actually next week here, because again, she's been a great friend of us here in Trinity, working on judging the external reviewer for our Provost Teaching Awards over the number of years, and we've brought in various changes over the last years that she's really helped advise us on, like a video that is used. And we're really very grateful, and we have a presentation for her next week, which I think is richly deserved as well. I think no one will forget Professor Robert Sternberg's contributions and his good humour. I think everyone was blown away by Georgina Smithick, and just the way a third year student had the confidence and the poise to come up and give such a presentation, never mind having the initiative to form something like Course Hub and see it running so successfully. And we really do wish her all the very best, and it's something that we will continue to support, and I think will provide a valuable resource. Our thanks to Sean O'Fallu, the Secretary General, who opened the conference, Dr. Anna Zimdars, who came over from London and has been liaising with me over the past number of months, and we will continue to stay in touch with her as she continues her brilliant, groundbreaking work in the United Kingdom. And a very special mention then to our keynote speaker, Professor Schwartz, who, as I say, we would not have had the conference if he had not been available. He has done pioneering work. I'm afraid I've used his report. I've ripped it apart to write my own sum up notes here, but it's a brilliant report that you can get online, Schwartz Report, Fair Admissions. And it was a great honour to hear him give an international perspective from all around the world and apply it to Ireland. And we will certainly maybe be calling on him by email for advice in the months ahead. But we're very grateful to him for coming over. I didn't want to demoralise Professor Schwartz earlier today, but when we were on the taxi back from RTE, he was talking about himself and his wife going off to Edinburgh tomorrow. And he said, yeah, but we're dealing with this airline, and it seems a little bit ruthless and a little bit strict and all this baggage. And they say you have to print out your boarding pass, but their system is down, but they're going to charge you. And I didn't want to demoralise him before a very heavy day by saying, well, we don't need to name it. We all know who we're talking about. And then finally, a thank you to the Provost for being the driving vision behind all of this, all these sets of initiatives in terms of assessments, in terms of admissions, and for his brilliant address this morning. But I did say that was the final one. I think the final thank you should go to everyone here who gave up an entire day to come and talk about this issue, to listen, to exchange ideas, to explore the problems and see if we come up with possible solutions. We have glasses of wine. I'm afraid it is the era of austerity. We only had sandwiches and coffee for you at lunchtime. Probably only a few glasses of wine now, but we'll do our best upstairs. But I think a round of applause to everyone here, because you made this all possible.